Welcome to our Holy Thursday, Maundy Thursday service this evening. Those of you who are here in person and online. Similarly, you can come here in person to worship tomorrow, Good Friday, or watch online at 7 p.m. as well. We will have communion at the end of this service, or near the end, and you may wish to prepare for that. And during the service, there will be several times where you will see on your screen where I say something and then you respond. So look for the P for pastor for something I would say, and C for congregation for all of you to say something together. And at the very end of the service, as we strip the altar and as Diane Hewitt reads the 22nd Psalm, which Jesus said from the cross, there will be a final presentation of the crown of thorns, and we will end this service in silence. Let us begin. Welcome, fools. Some think us fools for worshiping on a day such as this. You know, St. Paul proclaimed that we are fools for Christ's sake, and that God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise, and God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. So gladly, we are indeed fools. Listen to the writing of Frederick Buechner. If the world is sane, then Jesus is mad as a hatter, and the Last Supper is the mad tea party. The world says, mind your own business. But Jesus says, there's no such thing as your own business. The world says, follow the wisest course and be a success. And Jesus says, follow me and be crucified. The world says, drive carefully. The life you save may be your own. And Jesus says, whoever would save his life will lose it. And whoever loses his life for my sake, he said, will find it. The world says, law and order. And Jesus says, love. The world says, get. And Jesus says, give. In terms of the world's sanity, Jesus is as crazy as a coot, and anybody who thinks he can follow him without being a little crazy, too, is laboring less under a cross than under a delusion. According to the world, we are fools. But in Christ, we are holy. Let us pray. Lord, we enter worship this evening having experienced the joy and festivities of Palm Sunday, in which Jesus led the parade into Jerusalem. But this night is different. On this night, Jesus demonstrates the meaning of discipleship by enacting a new covenant and mandating a new command to love one another. By your Holy Spirit, write this commandment on our hearts so that we may learn to be holy fools in our relationship to him, him who loved us and gave himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. And everyone said, amen. Let us sing, and please rise.
Rest on his unchanging grace.
Eternal God, time and time again in days of old, you established many covenants with your chosen people. Through Noah, that God would no more cause a flood to destroy the earth. With Abraham, that he and Sarah would be parents to a multitude of descendants and nations. With Moses, you wrote on tablets of stone known as the Ten Commandments. With Joshua, in securing the promised land. And with David, through whose lineage you promised the Savior of the world would arrive. Through the prophets, you continually reminded your people to uphold their part of the covenant by responding to your promises through their trust and obedience. The testimony we have throughout Scripture is that God is always faithful, and he keeps his covenant with steadfast love. God is mindful of his covenant forever. God has established us as God's people, and he will be our God. God will not fail us or destroy us. God will love, bless, and multiply us and the fruit of our ground. God will never break his covenant with us. God's covenant will stand firm forever. The covenants God has sworn with his people are sacred, and they have been signed and sealed in blood. But then, like all of us, people forget and transgress God's ways. They forsake and despise God and break his covenant. They do not heed God's word, nor keep God's commands. They have broken, corrupted, and violated God's ordinances and statutes. But our gracious God has always desired to hold his people in a covenant embrace. The Lord declares over and over, "I will be their God, and they shall be my people." In baptism, God has claimed us in Christ, marked us as God's own people, and sealed our discipleship in God's covenant community, the church. Baptism is the covenant sign that God frees us from the power of sin and death and gives us the promise of abundant life now and forever. While God's grace in baptism calls us to live lives that are centered beyond ourselves, we acknowledge our sinfulness in missing the mark God intends for us. As a result, we sinners must rely upon God's Son, the mediator of the new covenant, a covenant sealed in blood from the cross, literally poured out for our forgiveness. In that forgiveness, may we joyfully respond, taking up our cross to follow our Lord in obedience and love, that we may be Christ's heart, hands, and voice in the world. Now for the lesson.
The Old Testament reading is from Jeremiah 31. Verses 31 to 34. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to one another, "Know the Lord." For they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. The Holy Gospel is from Luke chapter 22, verses 14 through 20. When the hour came, he took his place at the table and the apostles with him. He said to them, "I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer, for I tell you, I will not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he said, "Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you that from now on, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom comes." Then he took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And he did the same with the cup after supper, saying, "This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood." This is the word of the Lord.
Please be seated. Grace and peace to you all from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. In case you hadn't noticed, it's not only Holy Thursday, it's also April Fool's Day. Today and this evening. And I couldn't, I felt a temptation. Here are some April Fool's jokes to start off with. Did you hear about the guy who swapped labels on the pumps at the gas station? You didn't? It was an April Fool's joke. What? What monster plays the most April Fool's jokes? Frankenstein. Here's one more. I heard the letters A and C were going to prank their friend, but they just let her be. Had enough? I thought so. Oh, here's one more, a little different than the others that I found. This is April Fool's Day, so believe nothing and trust in no one. On second thought, I guess that's just like any other day. Now that last one is more cynical. And it is a good way to introduce to all of you the concept of a struggle between two views in life. The world's view of life versus God's view of life. We see that struggle tonight at the Last Supper. The struggle Jesus has with a worldview that warns you to believe nothing and trust no one. You see, at the Last Supper, and at every Lord's Supper since then, we witness a struggle between the kingdom that Jesus had been proclaiming from the first day, on the one hand, and the society around him that sought to deny the reality of that kingdom of God, on the other hand. Now, when Jesus stood up and preached, say, the Sermon on the Mount and the Sermon on the Plain, these were sermons that started with how blessed are these people and how blessed are those people. With such blessings, Christ was contradicting a society that, like other societies down the centuries, denied the value of those whom he had blessed. The world denied, for instance, the value of those who were poor in spirit, denied the value of those who were poor in material things, of those who were meek, of those who were peacemakers instead of troublemakers, of those who were in mourning their losses, and of those who were naive enough to still be pure in heart. Christ brought outsiders to his table at every meal. People like tax collectors and prostitutes and others whom the Pharisees called sinners. Now, these so-called sinners were the many people who did not live perfect lives according to the Pharisees' overly strict interpretation of the law. Why, the Pharisees hated seeing Jesus eat with just anyone at his table. And so they called him names, glutton and drunkard among them. That is the background to this so-called Last Supper. This Last Supper, which was really just the last of many amazing suppers that Jesus had hosted during his 3 years of public ministry. And now in the world's eyes, these revolutionary meals were at an end. Jesus himself admitted that this was the last time in his earthly life that he would eat and drink with those who had followed him all these crazy and seemingly foolish years on the road. How appropriate then that this is April Fool's Day. As Buechner said earlier tonight, in terms of the world's sanity, Jesus is crazy as a coot, And anybody who thinks he can follow Jesus without being a little crazy too is laboring less under a cross than under a delusion. Well, just as one person's trash is another person's treasure, so one person's delusion is another person's dream. And Jesus dreamed that night of the Last Supper. Oh, did he dream? He dreamt big. He dreamt that this was not the end. And that night, Christ spoke not just in one, but in four ways in order to proclaim to the frightened disciples that this was not the end. First, he told them that he would eat and drink with them again someday. He told them, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again with you until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. You see, he is telling them that he will die, yes, and eventually he will ascend to be at God's right hand. But this will not be really the Last Supper. Here, even more clearly, Christ is talking of a second coming when the kingdom of God will be in full bloom and there will be one long great supper. You see, Jesus is pointing the disciples to the future, and giving them a sure and certain hope. Second, Jesus does something new with this meal. He relates it to what he is about to do on the cross. He grants such meaning to the eating of the bread. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. He grants such meaning to drinking from the cup. This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. Jesus knows that he will give his body and blood for our sins on the cross. Jesus wanted the disciples and wants us to be constantly reminded of what his death was all about whenever we receive Holy Communion. Thirdly, Jesus wants this supper to be a model for a Holy Communion of love for use by the church when the church is created by the Spirit at Pentecost. You see, the Lord Jesus on that evening empowered the disciples to continue holding Christ's meal for everyone. Jesus wanted his church to continue this meal with himself as spiritual host in the same way that he hosted physical meals on earth. And since then, confounding critics of this holy fool, Christ's foolish supper has continued throughout all of history. It's a supper spoken in every language on earth. It is a supper that brings people together who have never eaten together before. Why, I have seen over the years people being reconciled by eating this meal together. And I have seen over the years churches that used to persecute one another being reconciled by eating and drinking this meal together. I have seen the faces of those both giving the meal and taking the meal. Faces touched with awe and suffused with holiness. This Last Supper became the Lord's Supper. And through the Lord's Supper, Jesus Christ continues to bring us together. But this meal brings us together to do what? And here's the fourth great thing Jesus did at the so-called Last Supper. He dedicated drinking the holy cup as a remembrance of the new covenant inaugurated by Christ's death and resurrection. We heard the new covenant prophecy from Jeremiah earlier tonight. It is a new covenant that improves upon the old because it relies solely on God's power and God's Spirit. This new covenant is less about what we have to do on our own and more to do with what God does to ensure our salvation and inspire us to do God's will. Listen closely, for in this passage, God is only talking about what God is going to do. I will put my law within them, he says, and I will write it on their hearts. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, know the Lord, for they will all know me. From the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. This so-called Last Supper is, in this sense, really the first supper of the new covenant kingdom. Now we, the body of Christ, join with Christ our head to host not only all of our communions, but also we will strive to live by the new covenant, by the Holy Spirit. You know, Paul once corrected the church in Corinth because they were not eating this meal together or in the right spirit. The rich Corinthians, who did not have to work long hours, got to the evening supper early and on a routine basis ate all the food and got drunk before their fellow members who were poor and had to work long hours, could even arrive. Paul told the rich Christians in Corinth that they had eaten the supper in an unworthy manner. Why? Well, because he said they did not discern the body, the togetherness of all their fellow Christians in Corinth. They were not pausing to make sure that the least of these among them had joined them to eat the food. So Paul urged the rich ones to wait and eat and drink the supper together with the poor ones as a sign of their equality and their unity in the Lord, as a sign that they were indeed a new covenant community. What it means to be a new covenant community is that we serve the least of these as Jesus did and as he calls us to do. In fulfilling God's call, we may look like fools sometimes, if we have to. But we don't mind. We don't mind that because we know the first fool is God himself. As Paul wrote, the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom. As Deborah Dean Murphy has written, into the chaos and confusion of human existence, the God of heaven stoops to dwell. Into deceit and double dealing, into the misery, fraud, and loneliness of our small lives, into this and more, the Word, she says, became incarnate and lived among us, full of grace and truth. Then Murphy reminds us about Jesus, that the life he lived led to the death he died. He loved others in a manner that the world called foolish, and it is that kind of unconditional love which led to his cross and which should lead us to our crosses. My fellow brothers and sisters of the new covenant, of the ever-growing kingdom of God, as you and I partake yet again tonight of this holy meal, let us also continue to partake of the love of God by serving as God's ministers every day. Sure, the more people we know, the more difficulties we will know and be a part of. That's the price God pays. That's the price Christ pays. That's the price the Holy Spirit pays. And that is the price that we pay for loving others no matter what. But you know, our spirits really wouldn't want it any other way, right? And why? Because you see, our spirits know that it is the way of life that really is life. Life abundant, life eternal, and true. So let us take Christ's body and blood into us, that we may go out and be good fools. What do I mean by good fools? Fools that pray, fools that worship, and fools that serve the world that God loves foolishly. Amen. Let us sing and rise, please. Let us sing to the tune of It Came Upon a Midnight Clear. Thank you. And now for the confession and forgiveness of sins. Tonight, as we take our place at the table of our Lord and he predicts our betrayal, let us examine not our neighbors, but ourselves. When he predicts our falling away, let us remember that the crow of the cock is more predictable than any of us. As we contemplate his imminent arrest, let us feel not only the pain of our great loss, but the shame of our tragic guilt. Then, as we anticipate his impending death, pray that we may be empowered to so live that he shall not have died in vain. Please now sit down and sit forward or kneel. Let us pray together. Eternal God, it would have been so easy to skip out on this worship service. Our lives are so filled with activities and demands. Yet we are here, drawn by your Spirit, to hear your words for us. We are called to learn the meaning of a commitment and discipleship from our Master. Forgive us when we are tempted to pull away from this opportunity. While we affirm that your covenant with us is never broken, we confess that we have often failed to fulfill your will for us. When we have pledged full commitment to you with our lips, we find ourselves denying you, betraying our neighbors, deserting our friends, and running in fear when we should be loyal. Though you have graciously bound yourself to us, we hesitate to bind ourselves to you and to each other. God, have mercy on us. Lead us once more to the table to receive the assurance of your forgiveness, and unite us to Christ, who is the bread of life and the vine from which we grow in grace. Amen. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. Jesus Christ suffered and died for us, was raised from the dead and ascended on high for us, and continues to intercede for us. In him we are forgiven and can now live freely without hesitation or embarrassment as fools for Christ. Amen. Please return to your seats. Now we will speak the litany, and again I will say a short phrase and then you will respond together with a phrase. Eternal and ever-blessed God, you sent your Son Jesus into the world to be an example for us. Fortify us with your Spirit's power and presence. Help us walk in his steps. Help us to walk in his humility, so that we too may be among our fellows as those who serve. Help us to walk in his forgiveness, so that we too may forgive as we hope to be forgiven. Help us to walk in his courage, so that nothing may ever deflect us from the way we ought to take. Help us to walk in his endurance, so that nothing may daunt or discourage us until we reach our goal. Help us to share in the life that our Lord once lived on earth, so that we may also share the life he gives in his risen power. Grant that it may be our meat and drink to do the will of our Father in heaven. And so grant that having suffered with him, we all also reign with him. This we ask for your love's sake. Amen. Listen to the words of Frederick Buechner. We are fools for Christ's sake, Paul says. Faith says that ultimately the foolishness of God is wiser than the wisdom of men. The lunacy of Jesus saner than the grim sanity of the world. Through the eyes of faith, too, the Last Supper, though on one level is a tragic farewell and failure, is also at its deeper level the foreshadowing of a great hope and the bodying forth of a deep mystery. Frail, fallible, foolish as he knows his disciples to be, Jesus feeds them with himself. The bread is his flesh, the wine is his blood, and they are, all of them, including Judas, to drink him down. They are to take his life into themselves and come alive with it, to be his hands and feet in a world where he no longer has physical hands and feet to feed his lambs. Let us rise and speak the Nicene Creed together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Now for the Holy Communion, the great thanksgiving on this Holy Thursday. Taste and see the goodness of the Lord. Christ has prepared us for a feast for fools. Let us then give thanks to the Lord our God, for it is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. From the earth you bring forth bread, and create the fruit of the vine. You formed us in your image, delivered us from captivity, and made covenant to be our sovereign God. You fed us manna in the wilderness, and gave grapes as evidence of the promised land. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. When we had turned aside from your way and abused your gifts, you gave us in him your crowning gift. Emptying himself that our joy might be full, he fed the hungry, healed the sick, and ate with the scorned and forgotten, washed his disciples' feet that night, and gave a holy meal as a pledge of his abiding presence. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body broken for you. Eat this and remember me and my ways." After supper, Christ took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant written in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of all sin. Drink this and remember me." The body of Christ. Oh, let us pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The body of Christ, broken for you. The blood of Christ, shed for you. And now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ keep you in his grace and peace, now and forever. Amen. Let us sing.
My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me, from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but find no rest. Yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel, and you, our ancestors, trusted. They trusted and you delivered them. To you they cried and were saved. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. But I'm a worm and not human, scorned by others and despised by the people. All who see me mock at me. They make mouths at me. They shake their heads. Commit your cause to the Lord. Let him deliver. Let him rescue the one in whom he delights. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near and there is no one to help. Many bulls encircle me. Strong bulls of Bashan surround me. They open wide their mouths at me like a ravening and roaring lion. I am poured out like water and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax, it is melted within my breast. My mouth is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to my jaws. You lay me in the dust of death, for dogs are all around me. A company of evildoers encircles me. My hands and feet have shriveled. I can count all my bones. They stare and gloat over me. They divide my clothes among themselves. And for my clothing, they cast lots. But you, O Lord, do not be far away. O my help, come quickly to my aid. Deliver my soul from the sword, my life from the power of the dog.